Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Evolution by Kyle West. Narrated by Graham Halstead. Chapter 1. 2 months after coming to Skyhome, none of what I'd lived felt real. My dad would always be dead. Chloe would always be dead. Bunker 108, along with most every other bunker, was offline and gone. The new players were the raiders, the gangs, and the empires fueled by slavery and blood. And if we couldn't stop the xenovirus and the voice, they wouldn't matter either. When we returned to Earth, it would be for more than mere survival. Our mission was to save a planet doomed to die. The coming mission was the only thing I could focus on. It was a way to not dwell on everything I'd lost. Together, the mission had become our focus. Our obsession. Everything else had been put on hold until we finished it, or died trying. Samuel had said Ragnarok was only the beginning, and I was coming to realize what that beginning actually meant. Everything would become twisted by the Blights, preparing the way for Xenofall. No one knew when the Xenos were coming or what they would be like, but we knew that they were advanced enough to have sent an asteroid hurtling toward Earth. It was only a matter of time until everything was controlled by the xenovirus, and through the xenovirus, the voice. Every day, Ashton and Samuel conferred for hour after hour, trying to hash out a plan that would succeed. These conferences were private, so Makara, Anna, and I found our own ways to fill in the time. I worked out, ate, watched movies, ran, and helped out in hydroponics 4 hours a day. Still, finding those black files had opened up a lot of questions when we had expected answers. We knew the voice was coming from Ragnarok Crater in a series of low-frequency sound waves, and that the xenofungus was using them to communicate to all life forms under its thrall. Anything infected with the xenovirus would listen to the voice's directives. All xenolife behaved as if of one mind, so something was controlling it. If we killed that something, it could spell the end of the invasion. Well, this part of the invasion anyway. The black file still stated that Xenofall was coming. I assumed it would be some sort of ship or perhaps a whole interstellar armada. When they arrived, they were probably expecting to have a planet tailor-made for them, covered with the Blights and all resistance dead. Assuming we did kill off the voice, we still had to deal with that. We didn't know when Xenofall was coming. Could be tomorrow, 1 year, or 10 years from now, or even centuries. By the end of the day, I was so tired that I usually fell right to sleep. There were times, though, when I couldn't. I suffered nightmares, dreaming of Chloe buried alive in the dry, red sand. I dreamed of the night when it all went to hell, and the monsters were always there, surrounding me, chasing me over bleak plains and jagged mountains. When I looked down at Earth, I could see the Blights festering like open sores when the blood-red clouds weren't so thick. They were only in North America for now, but according to Ashton and Samuel, that would change over the next few years. There was the rest of the world, too. The entire planet was depopulated to the same extent as America, or worse. Ashton called the 10 years following Ragnarok's impact the chaos years. A time when the world's population dropped from 8.4 billion to mere millions. Ashton had told me a little bit about what was going on elsewhere. In China, city-states and proto-empires fought amongst the ruins of civilization, the official government having long been dismantled. In Europe, extreme cold had completely hampered population regrowth. In equatorial regions, people were faring a little better, but a war over limited resources still consumed most of the world. Wars, I supposed, would exist so long as there were enough people to fight them. None of these people knew about the xenovirus or xenofall, and trying to communicate that through language barriers seemed all but impossible. In his first years in Skyhome, Ashton had visited different parts of the world. China, India, Russia, Japan, Africa, but always found one of two things. Either very few had survived, or there were so many survivors fighting each other that making contact was far too dangerous. Maybe the chaos years ended in 2040 for the United States, but the rest of the world was still living them. If we didn't succeed in stopping the xenovirus, all humanity was as good as dead, and not just humanity, but every life form that had managed to evolve in our planet's tumultuous 4.6 billion year history. When I left Bunker 108, I had never imagined that something like the xenovirus existed. All I wanted was a safe place to call home. Well, I had found my community. But now, we were the ones trying to keep the world safe. Hold still. Anna grabbed my hands, giving me a stern expression. She twisted my clenched fists on the hilt of her katana, forcing them vertical. Keep your grip loose, yet firm. I tried to do what she told me. I looked into her hazel eyes, which she promptly rolled. Stop looking at me and focus. Make your mind blank. Imagine a black plane, a void. Have you been practicing that? Yeah, I lied. No, you haven't, I can tell. She sighed. That's the most important part. You have to drown everything out until it's just you, the blade, and your target. Everything else is extra detail, and all that isn't necessary must be burned away. I held the katana as steady as I could. So, when do I get to swing this thing? Would you quit being perverted and pay attention for once? She sighed again, but it was forced. The beginnings of a smile tugged at her lips. You need to practice meditating. Once you get the hang of it, you can make your mind completely blank. I always do it before a fight. It helps my concentration. Makes sense? Good. You really need to practice it. I can't stress that enough. She looked at my arm, touching my left biceps. You're getting stronger. You've been working out still. Yeah, of course. I didn't realize you were such a fan. I had gotten stronger. All the rest, food and working out, had transformed my body. It was as if my body had gone into survival mode, knowing the importance of getting big and strong quickly. I'd put on 10 pounds of pure muscle in a mere 2 months. Samuel, who was training me, was incredulous, but he couldn't argue with the results. I still had a long way to go, though. I'm just commenting on your physique, Anna said. Despite this comment, her face flushed slightly red. I can actually see you when you stand sideways. You were so real thin before. Ouch, I set her katana gently on her bed. My physique, huh? She ignored my comment. I want you to meditate. I mean it. All right, I got it. I turned for the door. I'm gonna grab dinner if you wanna come. She shook her head. I still need to practice myself. Thanks, though. You've already practiced this morning. I practice twice a day. If you can wait a couple hours, maybe. We'll see. My stomach growled in protest. Between my hunger and her playing hard to get, my stomach was probably going to win. Suit yourself. Same time tomorrow? Anna had already taken up her blade, assuming a warm-up form and staring ahead. Works for me. I left her room and made my way to the cafeteria. After 2 months in Skyhome, I finally got the chance to see Anna a little more. Nothing had happened between us. At least, not yet. Even though she slipped up every now and then by seeming interested, it always seemed as if she was doing her best to suppress those comments. Which made sense. After all, we were all here for the mission. But when you spend a lot of time with someone, you can't help but think about them in a certain way. So far, Anna had only agreed to help train me to use the katana. I wanted a backup, in case I somehow couldn't use my gun, but I think we both knew that I was using the training more as an excuse for talking to her. At least this way, we could pretend it was just training. Some days, I could get her to laugh and let her guard down, but other days, like today, she was all business. Figuring her out was like trying to crack a code. As far as the training itself, it didn't seem as if I had much talent for the katana. There was no way I'd be even semi-competent by the time we went back to Earth. Still, after 2 months, I was hoping that things could have progressed a little more with her. And I wasn't just crazy. After all, it was my hand she decided to grab down there on Earth when the crawlers had been coming for us on the runway. And the way she looked at me sometimes when she thought I wasn't looking, well, let's just say there had to be something there. Hopefully, the right opportunity would present itself. Chapter 2. After a large dinner, I went back to my hab to practice the meditation Anna taught me. I was failing miserably. No matter how much I tried, my thoughts kept spinning out of control. I'd always been a thinker, but it seemed like my mind was preoccupied with remembering all the awful things that had happened down on Earth. I was grateful when a knock came at the door. I went to answer, pressing the button which caused the door to slide open. It was Samuel, wearing his characteristic muscle shirt and camo pants. His head, as usual, was shaved bald, and his facial features were sharp and toned. As soon as his sling was off, he had hit the gym in full force. That was Samuel's way. When he committed to something, he committed everything. "We're all meeting in Ashton's office to go over the final phase of the mission at 1930. They were the words I'd been waiting for. "We're going back to Earth?" "Yeah, we're leaving tomorrow." "Tomorrow?" I asked. "I thought we still had a couple weeks, at least." "It's go time," he said. "My arm's healed, and if we stay up here any longer, we'll go soft. Besides, the xenovirus doesn't take any breaks." I guess that much was true.
"All right, I'll head over then."
As Samuel walked away, a surge of energy rushed through me. Tomorrow we'd be back on Earth, doing something that mattered. I was already feeling more alive. While the rest of us were recovering, Makara was already working because Ashton was training her to pilot the Odin. They'd run atmosphere re-entries and even landings. Basically, she was learning anything she'd have to do during the mission. Apparently, she was a natural, which made sense considering how well she'd piloted the recon. I left my hab, entering the main corridor of the mid-ring. There was still about 30 minutes until the meeting, so I decided to eat some more while I had the chance. The mid-ring's main corridor was hard to get used to. It curved slightly upward along its entire length, and the whole thing made a circle, always spinning rapidly to supply Skyhome with artificial gravity. The mid-ring was divided into four quadrants: Alpha, Bravo, Charlie, and Delta. Charlie quadrant contained the commons, the clinic, and an archive, where there were computers, along with a rec room with a theater screen used for movies. The rest of the quadrants were dedicated to habs, mostly. My hab, along with Anna's, was in Delta Quadrant. Makara's and Samuel's were each in Alpha. Then there were the two other rings, the outer ring and the inner ring. The outer was where all food was grown hydroponically. The outer also contained recycling tanks and the water reclamation units, or WRUs. Most of the water was dedicated to watering crops in the outer ring, but every molecule of it was saved and recycled with near 100% efficiency. Anytime there was a shortfall, which only happened once every few years, Gilgamesh returned to Earth and filled up to make the difference. For power, solar collectors extended from the central hub around which all the rings rotated. Altogether, the arrays absorbed far more energy than the station would ever need. There was also a backup fusion generator in case the solar shields couldn't be deployed in time in the event of a solar flare, which would fry the arrays. Of the three rings, the inner was the smallest. It contained administrative offices, including Ashton's and the inner workings of Skyhome, called the Hub. The Hub turned all three rings of the station. Connecting all of the rings were the four tunnels, also named Alpha, Bravo, Charlie, and Delta, depending on what quadrant they were located in. The tunnels were arranged like the spokes of a wheel. Along Alpha Tunnel between the mid and inner rings was the hangar, where both Gilgamesh and Odin were docked. Skyhome's construction in the 2020s had pushed experts and engineers to their limits. It was no wonder they had only constructed one Skyhome when the original plan had called for six. All the same, Skyhome's operations were fascinating. It amazed me that the United States pulled off its construction. When I reached the cafeteria, I grabbed a burrito and sat down to eat. I forced myself to finish it, even though I was already full from my dinner 2 hours ago. Once done, I headed over to Ashton's office in the inner ring. I stood before the metal door before pressing the entrance button. The door hissed open, allowing me to walk in. I had only been in Ashton's office a few times.
Rather large, the office contained his built-in metal desk, lines of file cabinets along one wall, and a large workbench on the opposite wall. The workbench was filled with tools and objects of Ashton's mechanical tinkering. The office was rectangular in shape, and at the end of it, three large ports looked out onto the surface of Earth, a vibrant green and blue. Ashton sat behind his desk, regarding me with sharp blue eyes. The others were already here. I went to stand between Anna and Makara as Samuel stood to the right of Ashton's desk, arms folded. On Ashton's desk rested a thin monitor, and on a corner several binders were neatly stacked. The surface of the planet went by quickly beyond the port due to the inner ring's speedy rotation.
"Let's get started," Ashton said brusquely.
Ashton's accent was hard to pin down. He had been born before Ragnarok, and his voice carried a hint of southeastern regionalism that was most likely all but gone from the world. My only way of determining his accent was from movies I had seen, which admittedly wasn't a perfect standard of measurement.
"The purpose of this meeting is to give you an update on the situation and what we're going to do about it. As it stands, you all will be heading down to Earth tomorrow to resume the next phase of your mission. You'll be heading to the Nova Roman Empire to speak with Augustus. Make him agree to lay down arms against Raider Bluff and join us in the fight against Ragnarok. Meanwhile, my job is to monitor your mission from afar while trying to pin down the exact location of the voice."
Ashton paused, looking at each of us in turn.
"Samuel and I will explain how you all will go about that shortly."
"Have you figured anything out about the voice?" Anna asked.
"Some," Ashton said. "Makara and I have taken Odin on a few flybys of Ragnarok crater in hopes of securing more accurate measurements. It has helped. We have pinpointed the origin of the voice to within 20 miles. I need to get a more accurate measure, however. When our assault on the crater begins, you must be able to find the voice quickly and destroy it before you're overwhelmed. I still need more information. If I do two more flybys of the crater, I will be able to triangulate the exact point of origin of the voice. That's what I'll be doing while you are on the surface. I'm confident that with another few weeks, if not sooner, I'll know the voice's exact location."
"All right," I said. "What's our job until then?"
"There are four major powers in North America. There is the Nova Roma Empire, by far the strongest and the one who should be approached first. There are also the Black Reapers of Los Angeles, who have controlled the city for the past 5 years. Then there are the Vegas gangs. Last of all are bunkers 76 and 88. Neither have responded to my radio calls, but that doesn't mean they aren't there. Both have weapons and supplies that would be invaluable in the attack."
"Why Nova Roma first?" I asked.
"They are the most powerful. If Emperor Augustus can be convinced to help us, it will make the other Wasteland leaders fall into line. There is also the matter of the war between the Empire and Raider Bluff. That must be stopped before it can begin in earnest. That involves speaking to Augustus in person."
"It will be difficult," Samuel said, "but it is absolutely necessary. The Wasteland cannot be caught up in a war at a time like this. We need to lay down the facts for Augustus before he does anything stupid."
"So," Anna said, "do we just walk into his house or something? That sounds like a risky maneuver."
"Yes, that's the plan," Ashton said. "Before I get into the how, it will be useful to give you a bit of background."
Ashton looked at me.
"The story I have to tell relates to your father, Alex."
I was surprised. What could my father and Cornelius Ashton have in common?
"You knew my father?"
Ashton smiled.
"I met him long ago. He was still a boy, 8, 9 years old, maybe."
I did that math in my head. My dad had been 38 when he died.
"You met him before Ragnarok?"
Ashton nodded.
"I did. There was a summit for all the highest-ranking officials of Bunker One about 2 weeks before we were put underground. That was where I met your grandfather, Lauren."
"Bunker One?" I frowned. "He entered Bunker 108, though."
"Yes, that's true," Ashton said. "But he almost didn't enter any bunker at all. His wife, your grandmother, was stuck in Europe at the time with your father.
At the summit, he refused his birth until both your grandmother and father, then a child, could be brought safely home. President Garland refused that request. He and your grandfather were old rivals. Regardless, that was how your grandfather lost his spot in Bunker One. He did, by the way, find a way to get to Europe and rescue your grandmother and father and all that madness. Only by that time, the doors of Bunker One had closed. The spots for Lauren and his family had been filled. He was refused entry. I was shocked at this story. Never in all my life had my father told it to me. It was likely a very traumatic time in your father's life, Ashton said. He probably witnessed horrors in those last days of the old world that he never wanted to speak of again. Of course, that had to be the reason why. Part of me wondered, though, had my dad even planned on telling me? What happened after my grandfather got back to America, I asked. With Ragnarok's impact just days away, Lauren was directed to Bunker 108 in the San Bernardino Mountains. It was the only one that had enough room for three people. He survived a harrowing journey cross-country that was likely as dangerous as yours. Those days were awful, and some might say the world ended long before Ragnarok fell. He ended up making it to Bunker 108 somehow, because we received a transmission from him a week following Ragnarok's impact. Do you know anything else? After that, I'm afraid not much. I buried myself in my work. I had my own wife and family. He paused for a moment, his eyes becoming distant. All three passed in 2048 with the fall of Bunker One. I couldn't save them. I'm sorry, I said. It was long ago, Ashton said. The room went quiet. It occurred to me that Anna, Makara, Samuel, and I all had one thing in common. We had all lost our parents. Such was the case for many people. Perhaps most people in the world. I tried everything I could to rescue my wife and kids, but the dorms were the first hit by the crawlers and completely inaccessible. I couldn't have made it even if I had tried. Ashton paused as if it pained him to speak. They swarmed everything. Everyone was rushing to the runway to get out however they could. I headed to the motor bay instead. I could only hope my wife and children made it. To this day, I don't know if they ever got out. They would have touched down in L.A. with the others. I don't know either, Makara said. Samuel and I were in two separate helicopters. If they were among the refugees, they didn't say. It was so long ago. I don't remember anything either, Samuel said. I think three copters got out. One crashed, the one Makara was on. She was the only survivor. The other two formed a community on the east side. If they were among them, I'm afraid the news isn't good. They were acquired by the Black Reapers years ago. Ashton nodded. I've lived as if they were gone for the past 12 years. I wasn't expecting any miracles. No scientist should. Something chilled me about those words. Cornelius Ashton was a cold and distant man, but it seemed as if he hadn't always been so. After losing everything, all that remained was his life's work of studying the virus that had destroyed his family. I found myself escaping with two others, Ashton said. One was a mechanic named Dustin Cornell, and the other a pilot named Preston Yates. Cornell has since passed, but we all made it to Bunker 6, not too far north of Bunker 1. The bunker had been evacuated in the face of the coming storm and was still largely untouched. The crawlers had completely ignored it. We acquired Gilgamesh, not really sure where we were going, but Yates noticed a destination already programmed into the ship called Skyhome. I knew the U.S. had created a large space station in the 2020s as yet another failsafe, a place the president could retreat to if conditions on Earth became absolutely intolerable. But until I finally saw it when we left the atmosphere, I didn't know Skyhome's true scope. It was massive. So much so that it is a wonder the U.S. could ever hide it. Nothing about it was published during the Dark Decade, as far as I know, but during the time of the dictatorship, the press could only report what the government allowed it to. We all assumed that anything sent to space had something to do with stopping Ragnarok, and that was all we were ever let known. The majority of those missions had to have been for building Skyhome. Ashton frowned, then gave an embarrassed smile as if cognizant of the fact that he was rambling. Forgive me. I came to Skyhome in 2048 and have lived here ever since. When we first came, there was already a community of survivors from Bunker 6 who had used Odin to get here, which surprised me, because Skyhome's existence was supposedly only known to the highest-ranking officials in the U.S. government, namely the president and top military people. Apparently, though, a few residents from Bunker 6 found out about Skyhome and came here rather than going to Bunker 1. Bunker 6, you see, was attacked first. What about our mission? Anna pressed. It's helpful to know our history and where we come from, but if we leave tomorrow, we have to know what to do. Of course, Ashton said. But I think it is important to remind ourselves why we fight. If you do not know why you fight, you cannot go on. I want you all to ask yourselves what you are fighting for. Let the question haunt you, press you onward toward your goal. Ashton paused a moment. He lifted a glass of water and took a drink. After clearing his throat, he continued. Forgive me, Anna, but it is time for another history lesson. Not one that relates to me or my past, but to Emperor Augustus himself. You will want to listen closely, because this information is key if you are ever to get an audience with him. He paused. It was not only Alex's father and grandfather I met at the summit in 2030. Chapter 3. All of us stood in stunned silence at Ashton's announcement. You've met him? I asked. The Empire did not arise in a vacuum, Ashton said. It was controlled by a drug cartel called the Legion in the Dark Decade. It was not called Nova Roma then. The Emperor did not call himself Augustus, nor was he yet an emperor for that matter. He was born Miguel Santos to impoverished parents, and his life before Ragnarok could fill books. From our conversations at the summit, this is what I learned, or at least what he told me. He turned to business as a youth. By business, I'm sure he meant his drug dealings, for which he was infamous. Because of his daring and cunning, he rose in the ranks of the Legion. The Legion was one of the most powerful drug cartels in Latin America, and during the Dark Decade, it became even more so. Mexico became embroiled in civil war with the resurgence of the drug wars in the 2020s. In 2024, when Legion leader Osvaldo Casillas died in a gunfight, Miguel Santos, now known as Augustus, stepped in and took charge. All right, I said. What does an old world drug cartel have to do with the Empire, or anything for that matter? He's getting to that, Makar said. Santos, a very wealthy man, envisioned a bold new plan, a new country separated from the mess that Mexico had become. After hiring thousands of mercenaries, he carved out some territory along Mexico's western coast, in roughly the same area the Empire holds today, stretching from the old Mexican states of Jalisco to Oaxaca. This area includes Acapulco and other coastal cities. He called this area El Territorio de la Legión, or Legion Territory. Despite the violence of the Dark Decade, Legion Territory, ironically, became the safest place in Mexico. Out of need, the United States recognized its legitimacy. Why? I asked. What need? Because Miguel Santos became one of the chief financiers of the Bunker Program. That was why he was invited to the summit. He was hoping to secure a spot inside Bunker 1. So did he ever get inside? Makara asked. Ashton shook his head. No, I was, in fact, the one responsible for his not getting in. Because, Alex, he was hoping to take your grandfather's spot. What? I asked. That's insane. I promised to do all I could to keep that spot safe, Ashton said. I wanted his expertise because my scientific team was tasked with understanding anything related to the alien invasion. While your grandfather was gone, I publicly condemned Santos in front of the entire conference. Though everyone knew his dealings, no one was brave enough to point them out. People who did such things ended up dead. Because of my denouncement, President Garland could not give Santos his spot. But he also did not save it for Keener as much as I tried to convince him to do so.
Who got in? I asked.
In accordance with law, the berth was assigned by lottery. This was where it gets more amazing, because the berth was given to a Khmer couple and their young son. We all looked at each other, amazed. It had to be someone related to Samuel and Makara.
What was the father's name? Samuel asked.
The father's name was Pram, the mother Lakina, and their young son, Samuel.
All right, Makara said. That is beyond belief. Samuel was our dad. How many people were in that lottery?
Tens of millions, Ashton said.
Maybe there is some sort of plan after all, Makara said. Those are my grandparents and my father. How is that even possible?
It is an incredible coincidence, Ashton said. But a coincidence all the same.
Say what you want, Makara said. That is a miracle right there.
Why would you keep this to yourself? Samuel asked, the shock still on his face.
You must have made the connection when I told you my story.
Though a scientist, Ashton said with a smile.
I wanted you all to realize how incredible this opportunity is. How minuscule the chance is that we were all here together, and how we should never, for one second, take that for granted.
So apparently, my grandfather's refusal to be put in Bunker 1 led to Makara and Samuel's father being saved. It made me feel as if there was a plan, that we had been preserved for a reason.
Even more, the fact that Santos did not get the berth led to the creation of the Empire itself. So many things, including my very existence, hinged on the single event of my grandfather's refusing to go into Bunker 1 while my grandmother and dad were stuck overseas.
Let's get back to Santos, Ashton said. He was refused entry to Bunker 1, and his public embarrassment made me his enemy.
He smiled ruefully. I didn't think it mattered at the time. After all, I thought I'd never see him again.
Santos left the summit, enraged, and declared war on the United States upon returning to his villa in Mexico. Not that it mattered, anyway. There was but 2 weeks left until Ragnarok's impact. Despite his money and connections, it seemed that Santos was doomed to die like the rest.
Only he didn't die, Anna said.
No, Ashton said. He didn't. Mexico was not as hard hit by Ragnarok as the United States. It's warmer, for one. Global wind currents keep its southern portions fallout free, and imagery reveals many settlements are scattered throughout Mexico, their density greatest in regions controlled by Nova Roma. Post-Ragnarok, the Legion transformed from gang to government. Santos, a longtime fanatic of Roman history, had the opportunity to incorporate his values and ideals into his own country. He branded himself Emperor Augustus and renamed his territory.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.